Altogether worthy, all. Well, good morning. You know, I absolutely love I love everybody talking before church. That is awesome. I like hearing that rumble when I come up from downstairs and I come upstairs. I just like that a lot. It shows that we enjoy being together. Announcements, just a couple. Vacation Bible School is next week. Not this week, but the following week. So next Sunday, right after church, we're going to be setting up for Vacation Bible School. In preparation for that, this Thursday night, we're going to have a VBS prep party. We are going to make some things. We're going to paint some columns. We're going to make some Roman columns. Sounds much more difficult than it is. We have carpet tubes coming. We need to paint the carpet tubes. We need to paint some pizza boxes, and somehow we're going to miraculously turn those into Roman columns, and we're going to have some fun getting things ready. So we're just going to get everything out and ready Thursday night so that Sunday, when it's time to set up, we're ready to roll with it. So that will be Thursday night, 7 o'clock, if you're able to come out and help. Again, we're going to be pulling stuff out of the garage, and we're going to be also doing some painting and some different things. If you can help, that would be awesome. Vacation Bible School starts next Monday. It's from 6:45 to 9 o'clock. And I just encourage you to come out and just be a part of it. I don't care if you have kids or not. It is a fun place to be. And there is always, we always could use an extra hand. Somebody just to lead the kids from one place to another. Somebody to sit. I've learned over years of VBS that if I can get an adult sitting on this end of the row and an adult sitting on that end of the row, it makes life a lot easier for everybody. And we have a good time. I'm looking forward to it this year, and it's our opportunity as a church to just show our children and families that we love them and Jesus loves them. And it's a lot of fun as well. So that's coming up. Operation Christmas Child, there's a poster in the back. Each week in the bulletin, you'll see the items that they're collecting for the month. But I wanted to also point out that there's a poster in the back that has items that, as we go through each month, kind of what may be needed to fill in some gaps. You might, if you get a chance, stop by and take a look at that as well. That's something that would be beneficial. So thanks for coming and worshiping today. Let's stand and sing together. Thank you. Let's pray together. Dearly Father, Lord, thank you for this morning. And God, this weekend is kind of it's a fun weekend for us here in our nation. It's a time that we just kind of celebrate the beginning and birth of our nation. And God, I thank you for your blessings, and I thank you for the freedoms that we have to come and worship. And I just ask, Lord, that you would just bless our country and bless our nation. And Lord, as we look at nations all over the world, God, I ask that you would bless them as well, Lord. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for our time together this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you, and be seated. This morning, we have something kind of exciting. We have Matt Spencer is getting ready to go on a mission trip, and he's going to be going with Zach and Sarah with a group to Nicaragua. And I had asked him if he would just share just a little bit about what he's doing. Financially, he has his trip is taken care of, but Matt is asking if we would pray for him and pray for their group as they go on their trip. So, Matt, could you come and just share just a little bit about what you're doing?
Okay. All right. Yeah, like Doug said, I'm going on a mission trip to Nicaragua with Zach's church in Virginia. Me, and Dad's going too. So, we'll be leaving from Dulles Airport on the 8th and coming back on the 15th. It says, as things stand now, there will be plenty of opportunities for ministry. Among these, we plan to participate in open-air and door-to-door evangelism and around a local village. Additionally, we will be building Sunday school rooms at a local church, working in a feeding program, serving the hungry children there. Some of the women will be doing women's ministry there. We'll be putting a vacation Bible school on, so while you're doing it here in English, I have to do it in Spanish. And we'll be giving distributing eyeglasses to people who need them, giving eye exams. So it'll be a very, it's not, that's all in 1 week, so it'll be a very busy week. So I just pray for what I want to pray for, that we get there safely, that our health is good, and we can touch some hearts while we're there. And for me personally, that the Spanish that I learned 8 years ago holds up. That's about it, I think.
So, thanks, Matt. So yeah, they're heading out. Jim and Matt headed to Nicaragua, and I thought he was leaving just to get out of vacation Bible school. I didn't realize you were doing a vacation Bible school, so we're going to miss you guys. They always help out quite a bit at our VBS, but excited about the opportunities that they have to kind of pour into some lives there. Well, it's been a while, several weeks, but we did the same kind of thing with Andrew, where Andrew came and talked about going to Haiti and some of the things that he would be doing there. Now I've asked him to come and kind of share some of his experiences and what his mission trip was like. So, Andrew, if you could come at this time.
Missions all over the place this morning. That's awesome. Well, good morning, everybody. Like Doug said, I've been back for several weeks now, but it's really nice to be home and to just really take in everything that happened over that week. Again, this morning I just wanted to talk to you guys about what went on during the process of being in Haiti and kind of how I can apply that and how we can all apply that to ourselves. And before I say anything, I would be remiss if I didn't offer my most sincere appreciation to everybody in this church. Because of your generosity, I was completely funded to go to Haiti, and that is just a blessing beyond my comprehension. So glory to God. Thank you guys so much for that. That's just incredible. And likewise, your prayer support was also just so vastly incredible. There were so many prayers that were answered in different ways than I had been anticipating, but they were all part of God's beautiful plan. And again, thank you so much for all your support, both financially and through prayers. It made all the difference. So when we got to Haiti, we flew into their capital, which is Port-au-Prince. And within the confines of that very, very large city, it's their largest metropolitan area, there's a small orphanage in Haiti, and it's been in existence for about 50 years and has never really had a permanent owner. It's been in a little bit of a disarray, and it never had an owner until about 8 years ago when a guy named Jasper Washington came on the scene. And Jasper was born in Haiti, and his father left his family when he was very young, as a lot of fathers in Haiti tend to do, and he had fallen into a lot of really, really, he made a lot of poor decisions and drugs and alcohol and just other things that affected his life in really, really traumatic ways. And eventually he had moved to the United States, where subsequently he had been saved and he had met Jesus in a really profound way, and the Lord had worked on his heart to such an extent to where he was really struggling with figuring out what it is that he could do to be able to give back and be able to do God's work and be his hands and feet. And that eventually led him to moving back to Haiti and buying the property that he had once gone to school at. The orphanage also kind of held a makeshift school in it. And so he had bought the property and turned it into kind of a threefold compound with three purposes. And one is to house a regular sort of Haitian K-12 school during the day, a nursing school in the evening, as well as house 14 young gentlemen orphans between the ages of 12 and 18. So where did we fit into all of that? It's very interesting going into another culture, because I found out very fast that beliefs and religion and things, they're very strange in Haiti. They're very different from what we're used to. And the school itself that Jasper owns and operates, it is a Christian school, which is fantastic. It's so great. But they're kind of constricted by certain academic standards that Haiti has. Their education system is a little out there. And I mean, if you think American schools have issues, it's a little crazy. But we were able to go in and find out really fast that there's a lot of kind of inconsistencies in what they're taught in their culture and in their church culture. Ever since the kind of Papa Doc era of Haiti's history in the 50s and 60s and so on, there was a lot of voodoo and different rituals and different misrepresentations of the Bible that was kind of ingrained into their culture. And while most of that has been dispelled today, there's still kind of looming issues within not just their doctrine, but kind of within their culture and how they live. And one of the biggest things that we noticed and that we were told is when we went there is that Haitian culture is very heavily based on much more so of your works. Students, a lot of times in churches or different places, are kind of taught that that you have kind of a quota of good works that you have to do in order to get to heaven, and that, you know, what you do for other people, that, you know, the good things that you do, that's ultimately your salvation. And unfortunately, a lot of them have missed out on the fact that that while works are great and it's a fantastic thing, that it's Jesus who paid that price for us, and that our salvation is not something that we could do ourselves. So we spent the week coming up with the curriculum and coming up with different Bible studies and lessons and activities to do with the school throughout all the different grade levels, and it was great. We kind of focused it around Ephesians 2, where Paul tells us that, for it's by grace that you've been saved by faith. It's not by your own works, but it's a gift from God. So we kind of were able to take a week to create curriculum and base it to the school to be able to help them with kind of understanding the truth and dispelling some of the things that they've been told. We were able to further this in the evening. We were able to spend time with the young men who actually lived at the school in the orphanage. Yeah, that's them up there. And these guys were just absolutely incredible. I was so excited that I got to, as a pre-service teacher, I got to teach in another country through translators. My Haitian Creole wasn't really up to speed or anything, but it was exciting to be able to teach in another country. But just being able to spend time with these guys, have Bible studies with them, sing worship and praise with them was incredible. They had stories that you wouldn't believe and just hearts that were beyond my comprehension. I was so excited that I got to teach to them. I felt like it's just such a great opportunity for me. And while it sounds so cliche, they really just taught me so much about my own faith and my own walk with God, and it was such a beautiful thing. We wanted to leave them at the end of the week with a kind of thing that they could remember, a kind of takeaway from things. So we picked one of the walls of their school, and we decided we were going to paint some scripture on it and paint a nice thing for them, just to kind of remember, to kind of understand, you know, Ephesians 2, how, you know, we're saved by grace. And so we get this really thick, like, things are not very readily available in Haiti, so we got this really, the only paint we could find from this very sketchy store, and it was oil-based, and it was just really bad, but it was working, and we were kind of painting the wall, and we wanted this to be a surprise for them, but they're awesome, and they found out and came over and started helping us and everything, and it was a big mess, and it was a good time to just kind of talk to them and, you know, do something cool and just praise Jesus. And oil-based paint it was not coming off our hands for anything, so we go over and we're kind of getting paint thinner to kind of try and wash our hands off, and something very strange happened in that moment. One of the young men, it's Bertrand, he's the second one on the top there, he comes over to me, and he does something that really just changed my life forever. He walked over to me as he sees that I'm trying to get this paint off my hand, and he takes the bottle, takes a rag, and he walks over and grabs my hand and starts washing it off. And at first I'm like, buddy, what are you doing? Like, I'm perfectly capable of washing my own hand. And then it just hit me, like, who on earth am I that this young man who has nothing is going to be washing my hand? Like, that this young gentleman who just, it was incredible. And in that moment, I just really understood that, you know, that's God's grace, that's God's love in action. And I was able to see that in so many other ways, too. When we would spend most of the evenings, well off into the night, coming up with curriculum, how we could cater these lessons that we would teach at the schools to specifically to their individual learning styles. One of the guys who was on the trip, he was talking about the story of Jesus and our salvation. And in the course of that and mix of that, he had said something to the effect of how, you know, the story of Jesus and our salvation is like, he said it was the most illogical thing in the world. And I'm like, whoa, hang on there, sir. Like, that's my Jesus you're talking about. There's nothing illogical about that. And as I talked to him more, I realized, you know, from a certain school of thought, that actually is one of the most illogical things you can possibly think of. I mean, again, who am I that I'm going to be this person that, you know, God's going to look at, you know, this sinner that he's going to look down upon, and all my dirt and everything that's wrong with me, and he's going to look at someone like me and say, I want that man in my family, but not so much that, not even just that, but I want him in my family, and I've got a place for him at my table. That is just, that's grace, like, I can't believe. And just like Bertrand coming over and washing my hand, that's grace like I've never experienced before, and I'm so, so blessed that I've been able to experience that. And I hope that what we did throughout the week made a lasting impact, and that they can go further and tell others about that. Obviously, these boys have very, very little in their lives when it comes to just basic needs, and so I know in time, as I'll be reaching out more to Jasper, making other connections with them down there, and figuring out ways that that we can support them through donations of probably clothes and other things like that. If I could be so self-indulgent in this moment right now, I would love to just take some time to pray over these wonderful, wonderful gentlemen. They have taught me so much, and I think we can all just kind of just learn a little bit from them, and I just ask that we could just go to the Lord right now and pray for them as we do this. So let's go to prayer. Father God, thank you so much for just the opportunity that you placed for this church to learn about about giving. And Lord, I want to thank you so much for what you've put on my heart. And I'd ask that I would be able to use that to further that. And I'd ask that we would all be able to understand what Paul tells us in Ephesians, that it's not by what we do. It's true that faith without works is dead, but ultimately you are the one who has saved us. And what Jesus did for us on the cross, that is our salvation, Lord. And I thank you so much for that. And Lord, as we take the time in our comfortable lifestyles to just take a small glimpse into what other people are experiencing in their lives, Lord, I'd ask that you would just place your hand on these wonderful 14 young gentlemen who are slowly beginning to enter into a world that's can be scary, that can be difficult. They don't have father figures. They have very, very little. But Lord, I would ask that you would just be able to give them the resolve and the understanding to always fall back on you, and just understand that no matter what, that you are constant in their lives, and that we could parallel that image by understanding that God is constant in our lives, and understand how we can serve others, not for ourselves, not because we think that that's going to be what saves us, but Lord, we know the truth, and we know that is that your son Jesus came down from heaven and died for us, so that we could be in heaven with you someday. Lord, we ask that you would just let us understand that, let these young gentlemen understand that, and just give us that opportunity to apply that to our lives. Lord, we love you so much. We thank you for this space right now, and it's in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Twofold. One, we have an opportunity to show people some places that you or I may never go, that our church loves them, and that they are special in the sight of God, and that we care about them, and hopefully we'll be able to continue and show that
in the future. And the second thing is it allows our young people to be exposed to a part of the world that they may never see, and see needs, and realize that just how blessed we are, and that we have a responsibility to do something with that, not only just with our material blessings, but also with the way God has blessed us. So thank you so much for being a church that has been so supportive over the years with that, and let's just continue to pray. Thank you, Andrew, for sharing, and Matt, we'll be praying for you and Jim as you guys go on your trip coming up. Let's pray. God, thank you again for this time together. I ask you just bless now as we worship you through our giving. Thank you for the opportunity to be involved in just loving people in your name. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
I was covered.
man, well, this time we'll dismiss our children for children's church. And we're going to be in Malachi. Malachi is, it's the last book of the Old Testament. We're going to be in Malachi chapter 2. We're going to be kind of bouncing all around in that chapter. We are doing this study in Malachi. Malachi is basically God speaking through the prophet Malachi to the nation of Israel, and he's kind of reminding them that there are some things that are important. There's some things that they're not really getting right. And what's happened is this group, they're going through the motions. They're just going through the motions, and they've kind of forgotten why they're doing what they're doing. And last week we talked about that God starts this book off and he says,
I've loved you. And the response wasn't, oh, wow, that's amazing. The response was, how have you loved me? And they were kind of going this back and forth, like prove it, this challenge to God to show and to prove his love in our lives. And so in chapter 2, we're going to kind of continue this. But before we do, I want to start off, just tell a brief story. Jack Canfield, writing in the Success Principles, asked participants in the seminars to agree with a list of 15 ground rules, all right? The ground rules were be on time, sit in a different chair after every break, no alcoholic beverages until the training is over, and others. He makes them sign a form in their workbook that says, I agree to keep all these guidelines and ground rules. On the morning of the third day, he asks everyone who's broken one of the ground rules to stand up. And he says, what becomes apparent, he writes, is how casually we give our word and then how casually we break it. Malachi chapter 2 is talking about the importance of commitments and keeping commitments. Today in our society, we struggle with this idea of commitment, and it's very apparent. If you look at relationships today in our society, relationships struggle in the absence of commitment. It's evident around us. I was looking at some statistics, and it's sad, but 60% of millennials today say it's a good idea to live together before marriage. 26% of the elders would say that before baby boomers. 46% of baby boomers would say it's a good idea to live together before marriage. 60% of Gen X says it's a good idea. 60% of millennials. Why is that? If you dig down into this study, you see that this group of people, they want to get married. It's not that they're opposed to marriage. It's not that they're against it. They want to get married. But as you begin to dig down into this study, what you find is that they are afraid of the commitment that comes with marriage because they've seen the failures in marriage in our society. They want to get married, but they want to get established first. They want to get financially set. They want to try it out first to make sure that it's going to be a good fit. And the reason is that many have not seen successful marriage relationships in their lives. It was interesting, this past Christmas, when did our group come from Virginia Tech? Anyway, we had a group that came from Virginia Tech. There were some friends that Matt had made when he was there. And they came and spent the night with us. It was a time they just were coming in town. And I love being with the kids. I enjoy that a lot, these college kids, very rambunctious, very respectful. They were awesome to be around. But at the end of their stay with us, one of the kids came up to me. He was a very dynamic. He was kind of the leader of the group. And he came up to me afterwards and he said, you know, I just want to thank you so much for the opportunity to stay with your family. He said, I've never been in a family to know that a marriage could work. He said, my experiences and my exposures that I have been seen in my relationships and what I've been around, he said, I've not seen that be successful. He said, thank you for doing that. It was cool. He sent us a Christmas card this year. It was a lot of fun to see that from him. But it was sad to hear him say The reality is that the reason why marriage is struggling today is because of the example that our generations have set for what marriage is supposed to be. And what it is, it all comes down to commitment. What does commitment mean today? And they've not seen relationships that work, so they struggle with the idea of commitments. So they have this idea that we're going to live together before marriage, and we want to make sure that we give it every opportunity to work. Psychology Today had an article that I thought was interesting. And it's kind of a newer version of a study that I actually looked at quite a few years ago. But the article is entitled this. It said, "Should You Move In Together or Not? Surprising Facts About Relationship Quality and Premarital Cohabitation." Should couples live together before they get married? If you ask people this question, they often have strong beliefs one way or the other. Religious views aside, what can relationship science tell us about the pros and cons of premarital cohabitation? And then it goes a couple of paragraphs, and it begins here. It says, concerns about premarital cohabitation may be legit. Substantial evidence associates cohabitation with negative relationship outcomes. Let me read that again. Substantial evidence associates cohabitation with negative relationship outcomes. Premarital cohabitation is viewed as a risk factor for divorce as it predicts later marital instability and poor marriage quality and less relationship satisfaction. It states the studies that they drew that from. It says, compared to married couples, cohabiting couples argue more, have more trouble resolving conflicts, are more secure about their partner's feelings, and have more problems related to their future goals, and then it cites another study to support that. It says, these findings are concerning for couples considering premarital cohabitation, but a closer look shows a much more complicated picture, and this article goes on. What kind of brought this to my attention years ago was, as a pastor, you know, it became more and more prevalent of the idea of people living together before they get married. And as I began to kind of look at it just on a personal place, you know, God tells us very strongly that is not something that is right. And so I thought, if God tells us this, in every other instance that I know of in the Bible, if God tells me something, there's a reason for it, and that reason is usually for my good. So I began years ago, to go back and look at these studies, and study after study after study shows that relationships apart from commitment, real commitment found in marriage, struggle, and what you think you're starting to do something to make your marriage more strong and more stable turns into something that can actually be a detriment to your marriage. Commitment, we are afraid of commitment in our society. And it's a sad thing because that is what our kids are seeing and that's what their kids are going to see. And so as you look at this study, this idea of commitment, it's not that these young people are opposed to marriage, it's that they've just not seen what commitment is supposed to look like. We as a church have a responsibility to show what commitment and what marriage should look like to our families and to our kids. Look, anybody that's been around the Wallin family much knows that we're as dysfunctional as every other family out there, if not more so, you know. And it's kind of funny because I won't give into all the personal things that happen in our house. My wife is saying thank you very much, right? Look, it doesn't mean that you're perfect. It doesn't mean that there aren't arguments. It doesn't mean that it's always exactly, you know, bliss. But with that commitment in a relationship, there comes a security that you can't have. It is something that we all long for, but you cannot have that peace and that stability in a relationship without the commitment. And that's why God instituted marriage. God gives us this opportunity to make this covenant between one another that we will look out for each other, that we will be there for each other till death do us part. And it's something that we need to show to our kids in our marriages. And it's an example that God uses in Malachi chapter 2 to show the importance of commitment as well. What's happening in Malachi chapter 2 is a commitment issues not just between marriages, but it's a commitment issues in the relationship with God. And as you read this, we see that that God knows the damage that broken relationships cause, and he expects commitments in our relationships, not just in our relationships with each other, but in our relationship with him as well. In Malachi chapter 2, I'm going to kind of skip around a little bit, but in verse 13 it says, this is the second thing you do. You cover the altar of the Lord with tears, with weeping and crying, so he does not regard the offering anymore, nor receive it with goodwill from your hands. Yet you say, for what reason? They're coming to God, and God is not really listening to them. And he says, why? He says, because the Lord has been a witness between you and the wife of your youth, with whom you've dealt treacherously, yet she is your companion and your wife by covenant. God is saying, look, commitment is important to me. Commitments that you make to other people, they're important. If you tell your wife you're going to do something, that's important. If you tell your kids you're going to do something, that's important. You're teaching them what commitment looks like, and they need that commitment, and they need to understand that in their relationship with God. Because if the only relationships that they are exposed to in their lives are relationships that have been broken, and they've not seen that, what else are they going to think when it comes time to look at their Heavenly Father and wonder, is he going to be there? Is he going to be committed to me? Or is he going to be like everybody else in all the other relationships that I've been involved with? It's something that we don't think about a lot, but it has consequences that go far greater than just our homes. In Malachi 2:8, he challenges the priest, and he says, you have caused many to stumble at the law. You've corrupted the covenant of Levi, says the Lord of hosts. This lack of commitment to do what they were supposed to do, both what they promised God they would do and what they were promising each other they would do. One thing I want you to understand this morning. God is not afraid of commitment. All right? Let me say that again. God is not afraid of commitment. You may have been exposed to a lot of circumstances where the idea of commitment seems kind of scary to you. And I understand that. We live in a world that's broken, and sometimes we're just broken living in that world as well. But God has made a commitment to you, and he will keep it. I don't care if everybody else in your life has let you down. There's one person that you can count on, and it's so important to him. He wants you to know that he will love you regardless. 1 John 4, we've spent a lot of time talking about. Let me just read that, because we're going to talk about it again this morning, because it's important. 1 John 4, beginning verse 9, says this. This is the love of God, and this is how it was made manifest toward us. God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation, or to die for our sins. So what God is saying here, and I talked about this last week, and I'm going to talk about it a lot, is that God loved you way before you ever loved him. And he's committed to that. And in fact, if you go on to verse 15, it says, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. But look at verse 18. Let me just read this. I'll slow down and read this. There is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. Fear involves torment, but he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. I'm going to read that again. I want you to really try to wrap your head around what he's saying. All right? Verse 18, there is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. What's he saying? What he's saying is, look, We long for a relationship where we don't feel insecure. Right? Perfect love casts out fear. If you are blessed to be in a relationship that you have experienced what that is, it's an amazing thing. What it means is this. It means that not that the relationship is perfect, but what it means is that even in those imperfect times in the relationship, there's a love that is deeper than all of that. And you may have your disagreement, you may have your arguments, you may have those times where you bump heads, but neither person in that relationship ever wonders if the other person is still going to be there the next day. Perfect love casts out fear. That's what every one of us is longing for as we're looking for someone to marry. That's what we're longing for in our marriages. It's a commitment that we make to one another. And it's more than just, sometimes we think, boy, I'm afraid to make this commitment. But if you're afraid to make that commitment, then you will never experience what it means to experience perfect love where there's the absence of fear and insecurity in the relationship. That's why this article that we read at the beginning, where it talked about the fact that there's actually more insecurities, more arguments, more of those types of things associated with somebody who's afraid to make that commitment of marriage, that ultimate commitment, in reality, they're actually causing the issues in their in those relationships. Right? God wants to tell us, hands down, I'm not afraid of commitment. I'm willing to offer you perfect love. I'm willing to offer you a love that will love you even though you may not always love me back. Because when you come to me, and you place your faith and trust in me, and I become your father, I'm going to love you in the way a real father should. And I will be there. That's why he says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. The thing about commitment in relationship is it's tough to get to that point. You know, we talk about the DTR, you know, the define the relationship moment, that moment in a relationship where it moves from one thing into something more. In Christianity, it's salvation. It's when you take those things that you've known about God and you decide that I'm going to make this personal for me. I'm going to place my faith in Jesus, and I'm going to give him my heart, I'm going to give him my life, and something happens at that moment. There's a level of commitment that begins from God to you that's something that you may, even though you may have never experienced, it's one of the most awesome things that there ever is. It's experiencing perfect love in your life. And that's what God wants. In these moments where you define the relationship, you probably remember your moments. I remember mine. But commitments are made. And in our relationship with God, God makes some commitments to us whenever we give our hearts and our lives to him. And if you read this, it says this. It says that this is the testimony in 1 John 5 that God's given us eternal life. This life's in his son. He who has a son has life. He who does not have the son of God does not have life. These things I've written to you who believe in the name of the son of God, that you may know you have eternal life, that you may continue to believe in the name of God. What God tells us is this. He says, when you begin this relationship with me, I'm giving you something that's so incredibly precious. I'm giving you an eternity with me. I'm giving you an eternity with me. When we have these moments in our relationship, like for example in marriage, God takes this commitment thing so seriously that he calls it a covenant with us. And marriage is a covenant. What's the difference between a covenant and a contract? Well, a covenant defines a relationship. covenant is typically unconditional. There are conditional covenants mentioned in the Bible, but most of them are unconditional. Covenants often include some type of a symbol of their significance. In marriage, it's the idea of placing the ring. The ring is a symbol of a covenant that was made between a man and a woman. But unlike contracts, a covenant carried no expiration date. The parties were both understood to be bound by the covenant until death. A contract's enforced by the government, a covenant's regulated by God. A covenant binds two parties together personally. God defines our relationship through a covenant. And it's interesting because if you read the Bible, you're going to see it's divided into two sections, the Old Testament and the New Testament, right? If you read the way God describes that in Hebrews, he talks about the Old Testament or the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. God's defining the relationship for us is the Bible. And in the New Testament, as we read the New Testament, we get to see what the promises that God has for us in this relationship that we have. As we read the New Testament, we see the responsibilities that we promise that we're going to bring into this relationship, our responsibilities and commitments to the relationship as well. So in Malachi chapter 2, what's happened is this. The nation of Israel has made these covenants with God. God has made this covenant with the nation of Israel, this covenant specifically with Levi and with the priests. And there are commitments that were supposed to be a part of that. And the reason why God made this, because if you read in Malachi, you're going to see that God blesses him because Levi did some things. And the first thing that he did in verse 5 in Malachi chapter 2 was Levi feared God. And that's one of the things that God expects and wants for us to do. He wants us to be committed to fearing him. Now, when we say fear, we often think, you know, I'm afraid, but it's much, much more than that. It's not that we should be afraid of God, but it's more the idea is that if God is everything that we say that he is, then we should respect that. If God created everything and he's all-powerful and he's done all these things in our lives, we should respect that. It's a reverence. It's kind of what he's talking about here. Our responsibility and our relationship with God is to respect him, to be in awe of him. Levi did that. And because of that, God says, my covenant was with him, and it was one of life and peace. Why is it life and peace? Because when we commit to a covenant or a relationship with God, with that commitment, one of the good things that comes with it is life and peace in our lives. Just like as we make commitments in our marriages, what comes with it? Peace and security and those things that we long for in all of our relationships. Look, we're all longing for somebody to just care about us for who we are, in spite of who we are. God has made the commitment to do that in our lives. He made this commitment to the children of Israel. He made it because Levi feared God. He made it because verse 6 says Levi told the truth about God. The law of truth was in his mouth. He made that because Levi walked with God. Levi spent time in that relationship with God. He made that because Levi took his relationship with God and turned it outward. And if you look at verse 6, it says, he walked with me and peace and iniquity, and he turned many away from iniquity. All right, he turned many away from me and from many away from iniquity. All right, so what Levi did was he took this commitment that he made with God, and then it began to give it an outward focus to those around him. What happens in any type of relationship, whether it's our relationship with our family, with our husband and wives, or with a friend, we become more and more confident in that relationship. We lose more and more of our fears and insecurities, and we're able to become more and more effective to those around us. Look, there are times I've shared, you know, I may go to work and there may be problems at work, or there may be something that comes up. But guess what? You know, it bothers me like it does everybody else. But the reality is that I know I'm going to come home, and my wife still loves me. My dog's still going to come whenever I open the door, you know, and my kids still care about me. And if all those other people at work may get mad at me, or if that's the case, that's okay, because I still have this solid thing in my life that I can come back to. And beyond that, I have something more. I have a relationship with God that if everything falls apart around me, I know that that will always be solid in my life. So what does that do? It gives us a peace. It gives us confidence. It gives us self-assurance. It's a God assurance. But it gives us the ability to step outside and turn our focus, not just on ourselves, but to others. Levi did these things. He turned many away from iniquity, and he had an outward focus in his relationship. If you read Malachi chapter 2, we're not going to read the whole thing. What you're going to find is this. You're going to find a tremendous promises for not being afraid to take that step of commitment to God, for not being afraid to take that step of commitment to others. You're also going to find that there are consequences for not being committed as well. The consequences that we see in our relationships are very evident around us as we see what happens as relationships fall apart because of a lack of commitment. We see the damages and we see the hurts that come as a result of that. We live in a broken world. But we also see something amazing that comes when we get it right. God wants us to know that he does not have commitment issues. That as we turn to him and we love him, God will always love us back. And that is amazing. That's amazing. He reminds us in Malachi chapter 2 that we need to use the examples and opportunities in our lives where we have commitments to show that the importance that they carry in our marriages, in our commitments to God, in our commitments at work. We need to be men and women of integrity who keep our commitments, because we need to show our generations that follow us that it can be done. You might say, well, Pastor Doug, that's awesome, but, you know, I've blown it, you know. We're all broken. The Bible says that we've all sinned, we've all fallen short of him. What do we do if we have maybe not been good about the commitments that we've made in our lives? Well, we go to 1 John 1:9. And we come to a God who made a commitment to us that even though we blow it, he's still going to love us. And then when we come to him and we ask him for forgiveness, that he gives us forgiveness, he gives us grace, and he loves us even when we don't deserve it. And that's what the amazing relationship of God is. That's what that covenant, that's what salvation means in our lives. That's what grace is. In John chapter 8, it tells a story of a woman who had blown it. She had been caught in the very act of adultery and drugged before Jesus. We know the story. What I love about the story is this. How does God look at you if you've blown your commitment? How does God look at you if you've blown it, you've done something that you regret? Same way he looks at her. He looked at her and he said, Who still condemns you? And she looked around and there was nobody there. And he says, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. God says, you take where you are right today and you start today with a renewed desire and commitment to do what is right. Malachi chapter 2 is just about reminding us that we need to be serious about the commitments in our lives. It starts with the littlest things. It starts with keeping your promises. With my kids growing up, you know, and we don't always get it right, but I didn't make many promises, and I didn't ever want to make a promise that I knew I couldn't keep. But I told my kids I was going to do something. I tried my very best to make that happen. I want them to see what commitment looks like. If I commit to do something at my job, I'm going to follow through with that commitment, even if there is a cost to me. If I commit to do something in my marriage or whatever the case may be, do I always get it right? No, I don't. But that's my desire. Church, we have a responsibility to show our children what commitment looks like, so that they can understand there's actually a God in heaven who wants to be committed to them, and they'll understand what that means. What kind of commitment do you have in your relationship with God? As you read the beginning of Malachi, and I encourage you to take the time to read it, God, if you're not committed to him, God tells us that he will get your attention and remind you of your commitment. He loves us too much to let us wander from a relationship that can be so life-changing. What's your commitment to God this morning? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, this is a tough subject, because we live in a society, in a world where it's just, we don't see a lot of commitment. Not many deals made with handshakes anymore in our world. Not many things done by just giving your word. We've all seen and been a part of broken relationships and broken friendships and those things that sometimes come because of lack of commitment. I want to thank you that you tell us with no uncertainty that you are unafraid of commitments, that you are willing to love us exactly where we are as we give our hearts and our lives to you. That while we may always get it right, that you promise you will always be there. Because you love us, you say you'll never leave us or forsake us. You tell us that you loved us way before we ever loved you, and that you will love us and remain faithful even when we are unfaithful, because you cannot deny yourself. It's who you are. God, help us to mirror that in our lives. When people let us down, to still have a commitment to love. To show what that looks like in our relationships, so those around us can understand what you're trying to offer as well. Lord, every person here today, Lord, we need you, and we desire what a relationship with you brings. God, if there's anyone here who's never experienced what it means to be in a relationship like you have to offer, the promise of always being there, a relationship free from insecurities and free from fears, I just pray that this morning they would just make that step to take all that they know about you and have this moment this morning where they define their relationship with you and turn it into something more. Turn it into salvation. Thanks for sending your son to love us, to show us just how far you go in your commitment to us. Us to mirror that in the lives and relationships, in our dealings with others. In Jesus' name we pray. I invite you to stand as an attitude of prayer. I do understand that for some, whenever I talk about commitment, we mention that it's kind of a hard subject. But I'm just asking you, please don't judge God because of what somebody else has done. Give God a chance in your life. And what you'll find is that He does keep His promises. And it's amazing. It's everything that you long for in your life. As Andrew sings a song this morning, I invite you just to renew your commitment to God. Or perhaps make that very first one as the song plays. Father, Lord, thank you for giving us an opportunity to just come to your altar. That could be wherever we are. If we bow our heads and we close our eyes and we have this opportunity to approach you in prayer. I thank you, God, that we can come to you and know that you love us. Know that you are always looking out for us because we're your children and you're a Father. Perfect Father. Thank you for honoring your commitment to us always. Help us to be better about being committed to you. God, help us once again just to mirror that in our relationships so the generations to come can see what commitment is and understand who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much for coming today. And I'm glad that you're able to come and worship with us. Just again, Thursday night, if you're able to come out Thursday night, we're not going to be here very long, but we're just have a few things to do and get ready. Next Sunday after church, immediately following, we'll probably just have some pizza downstairs. And if you're able to stay for a few minutes, we're going to transform the auditorium into Rome, ancient Rome. And so we're going to have some fun with that for Vacation Bible School. So it's always a lot of fun. If you'd like to help with that, still plenty of things to do. See me. We'll plug you in someplace. Thanks so much for worshiping with us. Let's be dismissed with a song.